Before man, there was the land. In the rocks of the Finger Lakes and New York State, there can be read millions of years of geologic history. Knowing this helps people to read the landscape and to understand much of the history of those who inhabited it. Geography and geology help to determine the course of history. Over 500 million years ago, a shallow ocean covered this Finger Lakes land. Fossils tell the story of what existed beneath those waters. For the more than 300 million years this ocean lasted, sand, mud, lime, and salt deposits built up, layer upon layer, on the underlying crystalline bedrock of the ocean floor. Over millions of years, the weight of the accumulated sediments pressed the lower layers into sandstone, shale, limestone, and salt deposits. In the Finger Lakes area, these layers of sedimentary rock are about 8,000 feet thick. Wherever cuts have been made in these hills, by nature or man, the layers of stone are exposed. We see them in the 600-foot canyon walls at Letchworth Park, the 7-mile Genesee Gorge at Rochester, in Watkins Glen, a pothole type of gorge where each step covers a 500,000 years, at Taganic Falls, the highest falls in the northeastern United States, 48 feet higher than Niagara, in the fjord-like Palisades at the south end of the lakes, and even in highway road cuts. Starting about 360 million years ago, the shifting continental plates caused this Finger Lakes area to lift. The ocean drained. Its receding water and ensuing rains formed creeks and rivers which flowed southward following the tilt of the land. The present Y shape of Cuca Lake demonstrates the original southward flow of some of the Finger Lakes area rivers. Suddenly and dramatically, about 1 million years ago, an earth-changing phenomenon altered the face of this land forever. In Labrador, snow and ice accumulated until it reached the incredible height of more than 10,000 feet, about 2 miles thick. Its growing size and weight caused it to move southward. There were at least two, perhaps four, of these massive glaciers. The glaciers spread across the northern hemisphere in North America, Europe, and Asia. In central New York, the lay of the land with its wide opening in the north served as a funnel directing and progressively restricting the southward flow of the ice. As the Labrador glacier moved, it picked up and carried rocks, gravel, and all manner of glacial debris. This material chiseled and gouged the V-shaped riverbeds, turning them into U-shaped valleys and lakes. Along its southward route, the glacier paused occasionally, dropping its accumulated debris, called moraine. This created many unusual land and water formations visible today. The most well-known example is the drumlin, 10,000 of which grace the Finger Lakes area. Some say drumlins look like giant inverted spoons, others like dolphins. In length, they measure from 200 feet to a mile. Their height ranges from 200 to 500 feet. The glacier formed them by streamlining pre-existing earth mounds as it passed over them. As the glacier began to recede, the melting water flowed over and through the honeycombed ice, carrying rock, dirt, and gravel with it, and depositing them at the stream's outlet, forming knolls known as cames, Cobb's Hill and Pinnacle Hill in Monroe County are examples of canes, as are smaller versions in Mendon Ponds Park. Eskers are long, winding ridges formed by the glacier. Hanging valleys like Canandaigua Lake's Vine Valley were formed where pre-glacial tributary streams joined the main valleys at an angle. The dumping of moraine also blocked the flow of the Genesee River, forcing it from its original route to Irondequoit Bay into its present path through Rochester. No one has described the meaning of history more beautifully or more simply than the Seneca Indians. Their words are inscribed on the mantle of the Ontario County Historical Society building. Neko gan gisdayan duk. Other council fires were here before ours. The first humans in this area, the Paleo Indians, arrived around 8,000 BC, approximately 10,000 years ago from the Midwest. Through the archaic and woodland periods, successive groups of Native Americans moved into and through this area. The well-developed Indian culture, known to us as the Owasco, takes its name from the key site at Lakeside Park on Owasco Outlet near Auburn. It was excavated by Dr. Arthur C. Parker, then state archaeologist, in 1915. Other Owasco sites have been found at other digs, including the Sackett site on Arsenal Hill in Canandaigua. In the 1970s, archaeologist Dr. William Ritchie suggested the Seneca developed out of the Owasco culture at the beginning of the late woodland period around 1100 AD. While the evidence in the soil suggests the truth of Seneca origin, their legend describes their birth much more dramatically. They believed the great south hill of Canandaigua Lake had opened up, and their ancestors walked forth from the dark of the hill into the sunlight. The cleft that split South Hill can still be seen. Pioneer settlers called it Clark's Gully. The Seneca called themselves people of the Great Hill, Ganundawa, and they called this land and lake Canandaigua the chosen place. For defensive purposes, they lived atop hills in fortified villages which the Europeans called Indian castles. As the Seneca and other Iroquois nations gained strength and defeated their enemies, they built open villages. By the late 17th century, they had consolidated many of these villages into two large cities. Tatiacton was the capital of the Western Seneca and Ganandaigun, capital of the Eastern Seneca. These two cities, plus several smaller villages, were all relatively near one another. From the deer and other animals that roamed the Bristol Hills in large numbers, the Seneca obtained meat for nourishment, fur and hide for blankets and clothing, and bones for instruments, utensils, jewelry, and decoration. The Indians had discovered the secret of agriculture at the beginning of the late woodland period, around 1000 AD. The period of settled farming began on the fertile flat lands at the north end of the lake. The Seneca farmers planted corn in mounds 12 to 18 inches in diameter. Beans, squash, and pumpkin seeds were also dropped into the corn mounds, and the vines climbed the corn stalks. Seneca farming, therefore, centered around their most important crop, corn. Backed by a solid and prosperous agricultural economy carried on by the women, the men could turn their attention to hunting and war. For years, bloody civil war weakened the Iroquois nations. The legend of the monster of Bear Hill may be an allegory of these civil wars as they affected the Seneca. According to the story, the monster devoured all the Indians except one brave and one young maiden. With the help of the Great Spirit, the brave defeated the monster, who rolled down the hill, stripping it of plants and soil. When it fell into the lake, it disgorged the skulls of its victims. There are those who say when Canandaigua Lake becomes dirty and rough, the monster is turning over. Certainly, Bear Hill is only scantily covered by vegetation, and skull-shaped stones can be found along the shore and at the bottom of the lake. For many years, Seneca, Cayuga, Onondaga, Oneida, and Mohawk fought each other. Finally, three voices were raised against these bloody wars among brothers. Daganoweda, the Messiah of the North, who was a Huron by birth and a Mohawk by adoption, joined Hiawatha and Onondaga of legendary fame in proposing a great league of peace. Jekansaysa, a neutral, was the first leader to accept the new principle of peace and power embodied in the proposed league. For this, she earned the title of Peace Queen, or Mother of Nations. Traditionally, her remains were removed to the latest capital of the Seneca Nation. Today, the Seneca believe that her final resting place was Ganandagun on Boughton Hill near Victor. The Confederation of Nations, called an Iroquois, Haudenosaunee, or People of the Longhouse, included east to west the Mohawk, Oneida, Onondaga, Cayuga, and Seneca. This great Iroquois Confederacy offered the principles and benefits of peace and democracy, but it was join or die. In the Indian Wars from 1626 to 1681, the Iroquois Confederacy dispersed the neighboring nations who refused to join. These were among the bloodiest battles the wilderness would ever see. A Frenchman, describing the war, wrote, "My pen has no ink black enough to describe the fury of the Iroquois." So numerous were the captives that the Seneca built a city for them near East Bloomfield, called Gondagari, about 3 miles south of Ganandagar. Even as the Indian nations fought each other, European explorers brought their traditional rivalries to North America. In 1609, a battle at Ticonderoga on Lake Champlain pitted the French and the Hurons against the Iroquois. Champlain, governor of Quebec, armed with an arquebus, fired on the Iroquois. Modern warfare had come to America. Although the English and Dutch held the coast south of the St. Lawrence, the French planned to control the rest of the continent. From their stronghold on the St. Lawrence, they followed the intricate web of lakes, creeks, and rivers westward across Canada and south and southwestward into and through New York. They established forts at strategic locations, including Fort Niagara. In 1669, LaSalle visited the Seneca at Ganandagun to obtain guides to the Ohio country. While here, LaSalle visited the Burning Spring in the Bristol Hills. LaSalle, failing to reach an agreement with the Seneca, returned to Quebec. In retaliation for the Seneca's harassment of the fur trade, a French army of 3,000 returned to Ganandagun in 1687. And under the command of Jacques-René de Brissay, the Marquis de Nananville, governor of Quebec, they intended to wipe out the capital city of the Seneca. De Nananville and his troops landed at the mouth of Irondequoit Bay and moved south along a path that paralleled present-day Route 490. Between Pittsford and Bushnell's Basin, Denonville expected an attack by the Seneca. Nothing happened. The French continued to move south along the present route 96 between Bushnell's Basin and Victor. In the fearful imagination of the French foot soldier, a Seneca stood behind each tree. In fact, Seneca scouts did watch the entire march from Irondequoit Bay, reporting back to headquarters at Ganondagon. Finally near Victor, the Seneca struck from ambush in a ravine located north of the thruway near the Willowbrook Road underpass. The Seneca had positioned 500 warriors in the ravine and 300 on the opposite side of the trail across from the ravine. The 300 warriors would fire on the French descending the slope, luring the remainder of the French army to come to the rescue of their beleaguered comrades. The remaining 500 Seneca would then attack from the rear, effectively cutting off the French forces. Military authorities still marvel at the tactical cleverness of the Seneca. One historian described the battle as though hell had opened and all the demons were let loose. Everything worked according to plan, except that a good portion of the French force had not been caught in the trap. The arrival of these troops turned the tide of the battle. The Seneca managed to retreat with little loss of life. Back at Ganondagon, they alerted the women and children and set fire to the city. When Denonville arrived at the Seneca capital, he found it a burned-out ruin. The French then set about destroying the corn crop. This area was the granary for the Iroquois. To the Seneca, corn was not only food, it was a sacred gift from the Great Spirit. The act of destroying the corn was sacrilegious. Following the destruction of Ganondagon in 1687, the Eastern Seneca group moved further east, establishing villages at the foot of Canandaigua and Seneca Lakes, and southward along both sides of Seneca Lake and along the Chemung River. The western group of Seneca drifted westward to the rich bottomlands of the Genesee River and on southward across and down the Allegheny to the Ohio River. The Battle of Ganondagon was a prelude to the French and Indian Wars, which historians date from 1689. While the fighting among the French, English, and Iroquois went on almost continuously for close to 100 years, history gives each war a name. Except for the treaty ending the French and Indian War, the treaties that ended each of these wars was more truce than treaty. The Niagara and Allegheny Rivers were the key to the Great Lakes, the Ohio and the Mississippi Rivers. The Western Seneca supported the French, permitting them to build forts at Fort Niagara and other sites along this vital lifeline. The Eastern group of Seneca favored the English and allowed Sir William Johnson to build a fort at Canandaigua. The site was near where the agricultural experiment station of Cornell University at Geneva is now located. The last of the French and Indian Wars came to an end February 10, 1763. The American Revolution, which began at Lexington and Concord, Massachusetts in 1777, came to the Finger Lakes in 1779. The colonists were eager to avenge Iroquois attacks on Wyoming Valley, Pennsylvania, in Cherry Valley and Cobleskill, New York, and to destroy the Seneca granaries that were supplying the British troops. To accomplish these objectives, George Washington devised the only planned offensive of the American Revolution, the Sullivan-Clinton Campaign. The three-pronged attack on Iroquois country was launched on June 18, 1779, from Easton, Pennsylvania. The main force of approximately 3,500 troops under General John Sullivan moved to Wyoming, 58 miles from Easton, where they expected to find boats and supplies. they were not there. It took 6 weeks to build new boats and secure the needed supplies. The second force was led by General James Clinton, who was brother of George Clinton, governor of New York State, and also father of DeWitt Clinton. General Clinton floated his army down the Susquehanna from its source, Lake Otsego. By a clever procedure of damming the river, allowing the water to back up, and then breaching the dam, the army was able to ride the crest until it played out miles downstream. Repeating this tactic saved the army many miles of walking. Eventually, Clinton joined Sullivan at Tioga in New York's southern tier. Meanwhile, Colonel Daniel Broadhead moved up the Allegheny River from Fort Pitt into the Olean region. According to plan, Broadhead was to join up with the other contingents of the campaign. Unfortunately, neither group knew where the other was, so in time, Colonel Broadhead returned to Fort Pitt. After Clinton and Sullivan had joined forces at Tioga, the army, now about 5,000 men, moved north up the Chemung to Newtown, the present site of Elmira. There on August the 29th, 1779, the only formal battle of the campaign occurred. A force of 1,800 Indians and loyalists resisted the Patriots for over 7 hours. The heavy artillery units under Generals Poor and Hand turned the tide of battle. After their victory, the Americans laid waste the villages and fields in the area. General William Tecumseh Sherman, of Civil War fame, gave the dedicatory speech for the monument which marks the top of the hill where the battle took place about 6 miles southeast of Elmira. With this victory, the American revolutionaries moved north down the east side of Seneca Lake to Canandaigua, an Indian trading center now known as Geneva. They destroyed the entire village. This earned Washington the title of Town Destroyer in Seneca history. All along the route, the Americans burned the Indian villages and crops and girdled their fruit trees. One writer noted,
"The business of this campaign would prove a strange task indeed for men-at-arms, a warfare against vegetables."
September 10th, 1779, the colonial forces crossed Flint Creek, moving on to Canandaigua. They probably approached the village over Lincoln Hill, site of the Community College of the Finger Lakes. Undoubtedly, they followed the winding path of Saltonstall Street, which skirted the swamp at the end of the lake and crossed Main Street at Bristol Street. According to legend, the Seneca women and children were sequestered on tiny Squaw Island in Canandaigua Lake. The army destroyed the entire village of 30 houses and large fields of corn and orchards. Moving west on Bristol Street, the troops encamped that night on the hill, eventually marching to Honeoy and Geneseo. There, a scouting party ran into a Seneca ambush. Lieutenant Thomas Boyd and Sergeant Michael Parker were captured and questioned. When they refused to cooperate, Boyd and Parker were tied to a tree. They were tortured and disemboweled. Mary Jemison, white woman of the Genesee, witnessed and recorded their cruel deaths. When the Americans found their bodies, they had been decapitated by the Indians. One American campaigner wrote in his diary,
"This was a most horrid spectacle to behold, and from which we were taught the necessity of fighting those more than devils to the last moment rather than fall into their hands alive."
Unfortunately, in war, atrocities are committed on both sides. With winter threatening, the campaign ended short of its goal of Fort Niagara, and the army retraced its steps to its base in Pennsylvania. It is estimated the Americans destroyed 18 villages and 160,000 bushels of corn during the Clinton-Sullivan campaign. Veterans of the campaign would soon return to their homes with tales of war and of the rich and beautiful land they had found. Following the Sullivan Clinton campaign, the Iroquois refugees fled to the protection of the British at Fort Niagara. Unfortunately for the Seneca, the winter of 1779-80 turned out to be one of the worst on record. All western New York lay covered by successive falls of snow to a depth of 5 feet. Many died from cold and starvation. While the Sullivan Clinton campaign substantially ended Iroquois power, it did not end Indian military activity. By the spring of 1780, the indomitable Seneca recovered enough to continue their guerrilla strikes against American frontier settlements. They succeeded in pushing the so-called safe frontier for white settlers back east to the Schenectady-Albany area. Finally, the fighting died down. On September the 3rd, 1783, the warring nations signed the Treaty of Paris, officially ending the American Revolution. While the treaty ostensibly settled the differences between Great Britain and the United States, no provisions were made for the Indian nations. The new federal government inherited the problem. The Treaty of Paris had settled the question of the Indian claims against the federal government. However, the question of which state owned what Indian lands still remained open. Both Massachusetts and New York had legitimate claims to Western New York. When a federal judge to arbitrate the contention could not be agreed upon, the state legislatures decided to settle the matter outside federal jurisdiction. On December the 16th, 1786, representatives of New York and Massachusetts met at New Hartford, Connecticut, to work out a compromise on the disposition of the land. On April 19, 1788, they consummated the contract. New York retained the sovereignty and jurisdiction over the disputed land. Massachusetts obtained preemption or the right of purchase to the Seneca land bordered on the north by Lake Ontario, the east by the preemption line of Seneca Lake, the south by the Pennsylvania border, and the west by Lake Erie. Oliver Phelps, as agent of a buyer's consortium, sent General Israel Chapin to explore the land. On Chapin's return, Phelps and Nathaniel Gorham petitioned Massachusetts to buy 6 million acres of the land offered for sale. The $1 million price would be payable in 3 years in Massachusetts scrip. The Phelps-Gorham Company now had to survey the land, establish a central headquarters, and, most important, quiet the Seneca Nation's claims to the land. On June 2, 1788, the Oliver Phelps entourage reached Canandaigua, or Geneva. On viewing the land and lake, he observed,
"I am well pleased with what I have seen of the country. This place is situated at the foot of Seneca Lake on a beautiful hill which overlooks the country around it and gives a fine prospect of the whole lake, which is about 40 miles in length. Here we propose to build a city, as there is a water carriage from here to Schenectady, with only 2 carrying places of 1 mile each."
He immediately charged his surveyor to determine the location of the preemption line, the eastern boundary of the purchase, and set out to explore his wilderness empire. This survey proved critical for the history and early development of Geneva.
"On my return, I learned from the survey that Geneva was not in my purchased land and so could not be used as the seat of the government and operations for the Phelps-Gorham Company."
So Phelps chose Canandaigua at the head of the next lake to the west. Now he turned to resolving the Indian claims to the land, a necessary precedent to occupying it. at a meeting held July the 8th, 1788, at Buffalo Creek, Phelps and the six nations of the Iroquois League agreed on terms. The Seneca sold their lands east of the Genesee, plus a 12 by 20 mile stretch of land on the west bank for $5,000. Phelps acquired clear title to the approximately 2.5 million acres of land for about 1/5 of a cent per acre. In addition, the Seneca chiefs received an annuity of $500. To ease the sale, special gratuities were also included. This was all the land to which the Phelps-Gorham Company could gain clear title. 3.5 million acres, the balance of the original purchase, reverted to Massachusetts and was later sold to the Holland Land Company.
Upon learning that the survey of the eastern boundary might be inaccurate, I ordered a resurvey. This second survey showed a pie-shaped piece of land called the Gore that actually belonged in the Phelps-Gorham purchase. Geneva had indeed been within my purchase and could have been my seat of operations, as I had originally intended.
Two of the area's earliest settlers were Indian traders, Seth Reed and Peter Reichman. They established embryonic communities along Seneca Lake at Geneva. They laid out villages and farms, and a cluster of log cabins grew along the lake shore. But Geneva's development suffered until ownership of the gore-shaped piece of land between the old and the new preemption lines was finally decided. While the conflicting claims to the gore were being settled, a group of Hudson Valley investors planned a bold scheme to grab a vast tract of land, including the gore. To circumvent the New York State law forbidding purchase of Indian land by individuals, they proposed a 999-year lease. The group planned to create a new state with its own army, and eventually to secede from the Union. The federal government and the New York Governor Clinton foiled the long lease conspiracy.
On January 27th, 1789, the New York State Legislature created Ontario County from part of Montgomery County. The act made Canandaigua the county seat of justice.
Constitutionally, the United States of America was only 2 years old. The omnibus law creating Ontario County also divided the land into townships. Bristol, Canandaigua, Farmington, Gorham, Naples, Phelps, Richmond, and Seneca. Throughout this period, Indian leaders pressed for a better settlement with the Americans. To add clout to their demands, they continued to carry out an effective military campaign against the Americans in the Ohio country. The Americans and Indians met once again in the summer and early fall of 1794 to iron out their treaty differences. While these conferences were taking place in Canandaigua, war continued in the West. In fact, even as they negotiated, both sides anxiously awaited news of the outcome of the fighting. The critical battle occurred at Fallen Timbers, 2 miles southwest of Toledo, on August the 20th, 1794. Since communication was chiefly by runner, it took some days for the news to reach the negotiators at Canandaigua. One day at dusk, an Indian runner appeared on the western horizon. He carried news that General Anthony Wayne, nicknamed Mad Anthony, had defeated the Indians at the Battle of Fallen Timbers. In light of this news, the Indians came to terms with the American negotiator, Timothy Pickering. On November the 11th, 1794, the Pickering Treaty was signed at Canandaigua. The American copy of that treaty is in the Smithsonian Institute, Washington, D.C. The Indian copy is at the Ontario County Historical Society just a few blocks west of where it was signed.
I realized that settlers would be drawn from the east only if Canandaigua and Geneva were economically and aesthetically attractive. I resolved it to turn this wilderness site into a frontier Eden.
His first act was to set up a land office on his estate. According to tradition, it was the first in America. The county, township, range system of land subdivision was also first used in Ontario County. Between Seneca Lake and the Genesee River, he surveyed townships each 6 miles on a side. Primitive roads and waterways were opened, facilitating commerce and settlement. By the end of 1789, 30 of these townships had been sold. At first, land transaction policies followed those practiced for years in New England. Frontier conditions caused the company to drop its cash payment policy and accept unsecured notes.
Against my better judgment, we accepted IOUs. There was no other way to attract potential settlers with virtually no capital. Most settlers eventually paid their debts, but meanwhile, I suffered serious cash flow problems.
In 1790, Phelps had to sell off most of his remaining land. A portion went to Robert Morris, financier of the American Revolution, whose son, Thomas, became a permanent resident of Canandaigua. The Morris purchase totaled $1,267,569 acres, including the 85,896 acres of the Gore. It was soon resold to an English syndicate consisting of Sir William Pulteney, John Hornby, and Patrick Colquhoun. They appointed Captain Charles Williamson, a former British soldier and naturalized American citizen, as their promoter, developer, and agent. Williamson began immediately to make improvements in Geneva. He plotted the village layout atop the bluff instead of at its base near the swamps. Lots sold for $375. A deed restriction prohibited the erection of any building on the east side of the street so that the magnificent lake view would be unobstructed. The preemption line controversy continued to plague Geneva's development. Not until April 6, 1796, when the New York State Legislature recognized the resurvey of the preemption line, did the door open on Geneva's period of dramatic growth. A list of early residents give an indication of the high social, intellectual, and professional background of the people attracted to Geneva by Captain Charles Williamson. Among them were the Fitzhughes, the Dorseys, intimate friends of George Washington, and Robert S. Rose of Rose Hill, and his brother-in-law, John Nicholas. Williamson drew a number of other settlers from Maryland and Virginia through his southern connection. The Geneva Hotel was built by Williamson at the village's commercial center, Pulteney Park. In 1798, a visitor asserted that he doubted whether there were another hotel in the state out of New York City so spacious and grand. Once again, however, Geneva's fate was ill-starred. Williamson envisioned great traffic moving north and south on the Cohocton, Chemung, Susquehanna River systems between western New York and Chesapeake Bay. He had established Bath in the southern tier as his seat of operations at the northern terminus of that route. In this matter, Williamson's instincts were wrong. America's manifest destiny lay to the west. In the Geneseo area was another of Williamson's settlements, Williamsburg. It died of Genesee fever. The graveyard of the village contains names famous in the early annals of American history. The leadership of Williamson and Geneva's other founding fathers set a pattern of culture throughout the 19th century. By the time Charles Williamson's connection with the Pulteney Estate and the Finger Lakes area ended in 1801, he had left an indelible imprint on Geneva. In the development of Canandaigua, Oliver Phelps had the instincts of a city planner, one of the first in the West. The village was oriented around Main Street, which was 2.5 miles long and ran virtually north and south. Although originally planned to be 6 rods, which is 99 feet wide, Phelps enlarged it to 8 rods, making it one of the widest streets in America. Other streets were laid out in grid form at right angles to Main Street and parallel to each other. Remembering the village commons of New England, Phelps created a central public square. Upon this would eventually be placed many of the public buildings of Canandaigua and Ontario County. Many other villages in the county also have commons or public squares. Canandaigua Square was bounded by present-day Court Street on the east, Gorham Street on the north, railroad tracks on the south, and included Atwater Park and City Hall on the west. Phelps' own property abutted the south edge of the square. To assure the construction of attractive private homes, Oliver Phelps strongly urged his proprietors to settle and build in Canandaigua. Their presence helped to assure the economic success of the village by putting the investors where their money was. Phelps encouraged settlers to replace their log cabin stores and homes with more elegant frame, later brick buildings. Deed restrictions required a decent dwelling house to be constructed in 1 year, or the deed was forfeit. By 1792, most of the log cabins were gone. On April the 7th, 1789, Judah Colt was appointed first sheriff of Ontario County. So immense was the shire reeve of Sheriff Colt that, according to frontier braggarts, a deputy sent to explore the county disappeared for 6.5 years and was presumed dead. On his return, he demanded not only his old job, but also his back pay for the 6.5 years' work. The first public building erected by Phelps' own directive was a log cabin jail. He knew how important the enforcement of law on the frontier was to the growth of the area. Justices in the various towns were appointed on the recommendation of Oliver Phelps. With this power, courtesy of the Council of Appointments of the State of New York, Phelps kept considerable control of the judiciary. The Court of Sessions held court in the various towns created by the 1789 law. The first session was held in 1792 in Sanborn's Tavern near the site of the present post office in Canandaigua. This tavern courthouse, later purchased by Judge Moses Atwater, still exists, much modified, at 16 Atwater Place. In Geneva, court was held in the Patterson Tavern. Court continued to be held in these taverns until 1794, when the first county courthouse was completed at the county seat. It was a handsome two-story building on the site of the present courthouse and had such architectural embellishments as a balustrated cornice and a cupola. This was the first courthouse west of Utica. A number of famous cases were heard in this courthouse, among them the case of Jemima Wilkinson, the public universal friend, founder of a utopian community in Potter, accused of blasphemy. The case of Stiff-Armed George, a Seneca accused of murder, brilliantly defended by Red Jacket, a Seneca orator. George was condemned to death, but Governor George Clinton forgave the death sentence. Among the earliest religious meetings held in the county were those in the log barn of Phelps' residential property in Canandaigua. The first formal religious services were held in 1789. The Reverend John Smith presided and preached. Until mainline churches with buildings could be established, worship would remain in the homes. Still, the settlers pressed for Christian guidance and instruction. In 1799, with a population of 100 families and an economic boom, it finally became possible to obtain pastors and establish churches in Canandaigua. Two groups, one congregational, the other Episcopalian, had been meeting at the courthouse and school. On February 25th, 1799, the trustees of the Congregational Church invited Timothy Field to be minister. Around the same time, St. Matthew's Episcopal Church, now St. John's Episcopal Church, was founded. The Reverend Philander Chase was invited to occupy the pulpit. In 1798, a Presbyterian church was established in Geneva. 2 years passed before the Reverend Jedediah Chapman was called to service. He held services in the schoolhouse on Pulteney Park every other Sunday. A church building for the Geneva congregation was not completed until 1811. Now, at least in the villages, baptism, marriage, burial, and the other sacraments could be carried out. Caleb Walker, brother of Phelps Gorham surveyor William Walker, was the first white man to die in Canandaigua. His grave is in the Pioneer Cemetery. Dr. Moses Atwater, the attending physician and also incidentally the judge, walked behind the casket in the funeral cortege. This started a tradition that was carried on for many years. Grade schools were established in Geneva and Canandaigua in 1792. Groundwork for the first academy in Western New York was begun on January 28th, 1791. Land near the southern end of Canandaigua Lake was set aside for an endowment to establish an academy for instruction in languages and other branches of useful learning. Not until 4 years later, on February 12th, 1795, was an application for the incorporation made to the state regents. Incorporation was soon granted. Another year passed before funds were available to begin building the school. 40 persons endowed the academy with land and money. One half the amount raised came from Oliver Phelps and Nathaniel Gorham. A sizable contribution was also made by Charles Williamson. Classes were first held at Canandaigua Academy in early 1797. The first newspaper in Ontario County, the Bath Gazette and Genesee Advertiser, began in January 1796. Shortly thereafter, it was moved to Geneva. On December 16, 1796, the first issue of the Ontario Gazette, or Western Chronicle, was published in Geneva. 800 subscribers across Western New York received the first issues. After 3 years in Geneva, publisher Lucius Carey moved the operations to Canandaigua. The paper has been published continuously since that time. It is now known as the Daily Messenger. One of the acute needs for the frontier was transportation. The natural waterways were inadequate. The paths and roads, such as they were impossible. On April 8, 1789, 11 of Oliver Phelps' men left Massachusetts to begin work, clearing the water route and marking the way for New England Yankees to migrate westward to the Genesee country. As a result, the outlet of Canandaigua Lake and also Wood Creek, linking the Mohawk and Oneida Lake, were cleared. Several times during the winter of 1788-89, Phelps and Gorham petitioned the governor and legislature for roads. Each time, they were rejected. Phelps and Gorham offered to build the road at the expense of their company. Still, the state and the surveyor general appeared reluctant. Near the end of July 1789, Nathaniel Gorham reported to Oliver Phelps that Governor Clinton was leaning with favor toward the construction of a road. Finally, Simeon DeWitt, the surveyor general, reported the acceptance of the road proposal. On December 12, 1789, Phelps signed a contract. by spring of 1790, a road wide enough to serve settlers and traders was opened from Mohawk to Kanadasaga, which became Geneva. The federal government established a weekly mail route between Utica and Canandaigua as early as 1791. 6 years later, due in part to the efforts of Charles Williamson, the state legislature authorized the construction of a number of great roads. Residents of the area served by the road subscribed 4,000 days' labor and quickly improved the road to a width of 64 feet. On September the 20th of that same year, 1797, stagecoach service between Utica and Geneva was inaugurated. Such a trip took 3 days. Within a very short time, service was extended to Canandaigua. Seneca Turnpike was incorporated on April 1, 1800, with a capital stock of $110,000. This artery of commerce, now New York Route 5 and U.S. Route 20, nourished a string of lovely and prosperous villages at the northern ends of the Finger Lakes, including Skaneateles, Auburn, Seneca Falls, Geneva, and Canandaigua. By 1800, the western frontier had passed through Ontario County into western New York and Ohio. The foundations of civilization had been established here, and the first decade of the 19th century would see a refinement of local government, society, culture, religion, and economy. The men most responsible for the settlement and development of the county passed from history's view. In 1801, Charles Williamson's association with the Pulteney Estate and with Ontario County ended. He returned to his family home in Scotland and died in 1808. Oliver Phelps, at one time the richest man on the frontier, spent his last days in debtor's prison. Land poor and with no cash to pay his debts, he died on February 21st, 1809. Phelps and Gorham, Williamson, and the pioneer patriots of Western New York, and others like them, rest much of the greatness of America today. Here in this Finger Lakes land of promise, our new nation began a manifest destiny which would carry America across this continent to the Pacific coast and beyond. 2,000 years ago, the bounty and beauty of the rich soil and sweet waters of the Finger Lakes drew man to this land. The Seneca, keepers of the western gateway of the Iroquois Confederacy, chose this place as their home. After the wars in the wilderness and the American Revolution, Yankees settled here. Ontario County was created on January 27, 1789, by the New York State Legislature. It was originally part of Montgomery County. The people of Ontario County, this land of promise, influenced and directed events far beyond our borders. Watch as from 1812 to 1865, the land becomes a nation. To our founding fathers fell the challenge of the age to explore and settle the land and to transform the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution of the United States, and this very land into a nation indivisible. It was not always done peacefully. Although the American Revolution freed the 13 colonies from British rule, hostility between the two countries continued. England's presence in Canada and the wilderness lands west of New York was a threat to the settlers. To protect the frontier, New York State built several arsenals in 1808. In Canandaigua, this is still called Arsenal Hill. There was increased attention paid to the local militia. The diplomatic and political issues of the time included the impressment of American sailors and trade restrictions. On June 18, 1812, the United States declared war on England. Behind me, the Niagara River separates the United States from Canada. For about 30 miles, the river flows north from Lake Erie over Niagara Falls to Lake Ontario. On both sides, the Niagara frontier bristled with batteries and forts. It became one of the most active theaters of the War of 1812. The bombings during some of these battles, said local militiaman Chester Loomis of Rushville, could be heard as far as Canandaigua and Gorham in Ontario County. Near this site, a volunteer militia officer, Archer Galloway from Palmyra, then a part of Ontario County, fired the first shot of the War of 1812. The shooting war had begun. Local congressman Peter B. Porter was a member of the Warhawk faction bent on conquering Canada. From his front porch, he could see Canada across the river. Before moving to Buffalo, he had lived in this house at 75 North Main Street in Canandaigua, which he and his brother Augustus had built. 3,000 militia from Geneseo, under General William Wadsworth, marched to the aid of the frontier. Major Mullaney's Canandaigua militia also responded with all the arms and ammunition in the arsenal. During 1812, America made three unsuccessful thrusts into Canada, at Detroit, the Niagara frontier, and Lake Champlain. In October 1812, General Stephen Van Rensselaer from the Albany area led an attack across the Niagara River on Queenston Heights, Canada. General Isaac Brock, hearing the gunfire from his quarters at Fort George, galloped south to Queenston Heights and rallied his British troops. Although the British won the victory, they lost their brilliant General Brock. He became Canada's first national hero. On May 27, 1813, local soldiers commanded by General George McClure, a farmer from Steuben County, captured Fort George on the Canadian side. On Lake Ontario, several times during the war, militiamen were called from Geneva, Phelps, Canandaigua, Bloomfield, and Bristol to repel British invaders at Shalott and Pulteneyville. To control Lake Erie, the Navy Department sent Oliver Hazard Perry, age 27, to Presque Isle to build and assemble a fleet. Robert Barclay commanded the Canadian naval forces on Lake Erie. With Perry's fleet close by, no food could reach the Canadian forces. Finally, on September 9, 1813, the shortages forced Barclay to fight the American fleet. His base had only one day of flour left. Barclay's fleet came into sight of the Americans. Men assumed their battle stations. Cannonballs filled the air. Perry's flagship, the Lawrence, suffered heavily. It was quickly reduced to a hulk. Barclay sensed victory. In an amazing and dangerous maneuver, Perry dropped a rowboat from the stern of the Lawrence and under intense fire rowed to the Niagara a half mile away. With him was his 13-year-old brother, Alexander. Perry's new flagship closed to 100 feet and then fired broadside after broadside. Finally, the crippled English fleet surrendered. To General William Henry Harrison, Perry sent one of the shortest and most famous messages in American naval history.
We have met the enemy, and they are ours. Two ships, two brigs, one schooner, and one sloop.
For the first time in British history, an entire English fleet had surrendered. The Americans now controlled Lake Erie. Through the end of 1813 and the beginning of 1814, the British and Canadians again invaded the American Niagara frontier and burned Buffalo. Ontario militia under local generals Amos Hall and Peter Porter and Colonel Seymour Boughton were among the defenders. Men from Bloomfield, Livonia, Honeoye, Avon, Canandaigua, Phelps and Victor were among the casualties at Buffalo and Black Rock. Ontario County was in danger of enemy invasion. By the spring of 1814, American fortunes improved. Red Jacket convinced 600 Iroquois warriors to fight for the United States. Other Iroquois in Canada fought for the British. In July 1814, United States forces captured Fort Erie. Local soldiers fought in the bloodiest battle of the entire war at Lundy's Lane near Niagara Falls. Both sides claimed victory. Until the middle of September, American soldiers withstood repeated attacks on Fort Erie. Later that month, U.S. forces withdrew from Canada in the face of mounting resistance from Canadian militia. The war zone now shifted to Washington and Baltimore. There would be no more fighting in upstate New York. The British set fire to much of Washington, D.C., including the president's mansion. The white paint later used to cover the burn marks gave the building a new name, the White House. After the Battle of Washington, the British detained some Americans. A young Georgetown attorney, Francis Scott Key, was appointed by President Madison to obtain their release. On September 7, 1814, Key left Baltimore to cross Chesapeake Bay on a British vessel. Meanwhile, the battle for Baltimore and Fort McHenry had begun. The next morning, Key penned these words.
Oh, say, can you see, by the dawn's early light, what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming? Whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, or the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming? And the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave for the land of the free and the home of the brave?
On Christmas Eve, 1814, the Treaty of Ghent, ending the war, was signed. Before the news of the treaty could cross the ocean, the Battle of New Orleans, the last battle of the war, was fought. Although it had no effect on the outcome of the war, this American victory made Andrew Jackson a national hero. After 2.5 years of war, the Treaty of Ghent had changed nothing. Boundaries remained as they had been, but attitudes had changed. America recognized that Canada had a legitimate right to remain Canada. In turn, the British gave up forts in Ohio and Michigan. The soldiers returned home from the Niagara frontier. General Peter Porter returned to Canandaigua to be honored at Blossom's Hotel as a native son and a conquering hero of the War of 1812. The war produced heroes and symbols of nationalism on both sides. America had the Star-Spangled Banner and the caricature of Uncle Sam. This was modeled after Sam Wilson of Troy, New York, who supplied salted meat to the army. Sam stamped U.S. for United States on the barrels destined for the army. Soldiers remarked that the meat came from Uncle Sam. More important than the Treaty of Ghent was the Rush-Bagot Treaty signed 2 years later. This established permanent peace along a 3,000-mile boundary between Canada and the United States. This is the longest unfortified national boundary in the world. With the end of the War of 1812, the threat and fear of enemy invasion of Ontario County disappeared. Life returned to normal. Practically everyone coming to the Finger Lakes region before this time was, of necessity, a farmer. Clearing the forest, which completely covered western New York, was slow, back-breaking work. Muscle of men and oxen was the only source of power. Axes and chains, the only tools. The trees provided logs for cabins and rail fences. Huge quantities of trees were burned simply to get them out of the way. Lye and potash were extracted from the ashes. These products, along with furs and hides, provided the farmer's first income. Between the stumps of the trees, the farmer grew his first crops, corn, wheat, potatoes, and perhaps some beans or squash. Every farmer grew flax to make linen and kept some sheep for wool. Homespun cloth combining these fibers was called linsey woolsey. Wheat was sown by scattering the seed, harvested by a cradle scythe. The bundles were tied by hand. Wheat was the first crop produced beyond the farmer's own needs. But it was difficult getting so bulky a commodity to market. Many bushels of wheat, however, could be distilled into a keg of whiskey and more easily transported. To get wagons and coaches through the wilderness, Indian trails were made into roads. Stones and logs were thrown into mud holes and swamps. Then logs or planks were laid crossways to form a corduroy road. Few bridges existed, so travelers simply waded across streams at a shallow spot. Some highways were constructed by companies hoping to profit from charging tolls. By 1810, nearly every creek had at least one water-powered mill for grinding grain into flour or animal feed, or for sawing logs into lumber. In the winter, the farmer could make simple chairs, tables, and chests of drawers. Whatever the handheld knife, hatchet, and chisel could fashion. The completion of the Erie Canal brought a change in agriculture from subsistence to commercial farming and contributed to rapid growth in the size of villages. Now wheat could be shipped to the mills at the Genesee Falls in Rochester and flour to the East Coast cities. Other cash crops included potatoes, cabbage for sauerkraut, and fruit from apple, plum, pear, and cherry orchards and grape vineyards. Ontario and bordering counties were the breadbasket of the nation until the Great Plains were opened. By 1840, this area was shipping baled hay to Syracuse, Albany, New York City, and Boston. In an era powered by oxen and horses, hay was as important a commodity as gasoline is in the automotive age. A variety of occupations and businesses sprang up to serve the expanding population. The general store was the business and social center of the community in the early 1800s. At first, the principal sales were in items farmers and villagers could not produce locally: dry goods, medicinal items, tobacco, spices, tea, and sugar. Later stores carried a much greater variety of merchandise, including clothing and food. One of the most important craftsmen to both rural and village residents was the blacksmith. Not only did the smith shoe horses and provide basic veterinary care, but he also performed all kinds of ironwork. Watching the brawny smith as he worked at his anvil was a favorite pastime of little boys and of grown-ups too. Cobblers made boots and shoes for all members of the family. The tinsmith crafted kitchen utensils and lanterns for lighting the homes. The cooper made barrels. The potter fashioned dishes, jugs, pitchers, and other household items from clay. Druggists and physicians, often one person, filled both roles, ground their own medicines from herbs and other ingredients using a mortar and pestle. These tools came to identify the profession. From the earliest days of settlement in Ontario County, there was much buying and selling of land. Because of this, lawyers were quite numerous. For the same reason, banks were necessary, and all of the larger communities had a small bank building. Early on, the larger communities had their own newspapers. The type was set by hand. 19th century newspapers were devoted mostly to politics and advertisements. Local news was seldom printed or was extremely brief because everyone in town knew the facts before the paper went to press. These were men's occupations. What of the women? They tended the gardens, kept house, and raised the children. They spun yarn, wove it into cloth, and made the family's clothing. They milked the cow and churned butter, cooked cooked and baked and preserved food for winter. It was a common saying that man's work is from sun to sun. Woman's work is never done. Two inventions of the period did much to lighten the burden of woman's work. Elias Howe's sewing machine saved countless hours of hand sewing. The cook stove was more convenient, more efficient, and safer than cooking at the fireplace. The threat of fire was always present. Every household was required to keep a water bucket handy for use in case of a fire. By the early 1800s, many villages had organized firefighting companies. Carolyn Richards, a young girl who lived on Main Street in Canandaigua, wrote in her diary,
February 6, 1856. We were awakened very early this morning by the cry of fire and the ringing of bells, and could see the sky red with flames and knew it was the stores. Mr. Palmer's hat store, Mr. Underhill's bookstore, Mr. Schaefer's tailor shop, Mrs. Smith's millinery, Pratt and Smith's drugstore, Mr. Mitchell's dry goods store, two printing offices and a saloon were burned.
The increasing prosperity allowed the farmers and villagers to build large, beautiful houses. But log houses were not unusual right through Civil War times. Some of these new houses were huge, having up to 20 rooms to accommodate large families. A household often consisted of three, sometimes four generations, and may have included many unmarried relatives. Construction was usually of boards or brick, although fieldstone and cobblestone homes were also common. Yards were enclosed by attractive white-painted picket fences. The interiors of the homes reflected the more comfortable lifestyle. Once the kitchen hearth had been the center of family life, but now nicely furnished parlors became the family gathering place. Many of Ontario County homes date back to this time. In the early 1990s, there were at least 19 farms in Ontario County that have been owned by the same family for over a century. Three have been in the same family for over 200 years. Every member of the family contributed to the farm's operation. Even the young children had their chores. As agriculture became more commercialized and greater acreages of crops were planted, farms had to become more efficient. Oxen had been used as draft animals, but were slow and clumsy. Horses replaced them. Many labor-saving machines were developed by farmers with the aid of blacksmiths. Hay had been cut by hand using the sickle or scythe. A farmer named Ketchum invented this mower, first used at Geneva in 1845. Jethro Wood of Scipio in central New York invented a very practical mold board plow. An early thrashing machine was developed at Phelps in the 1830s. These inventions created a whole new industry in the 1840s. Factories were built in many western New York villages to keep up with the demand for the new machines. Plows were manufactured in Canandaigua and Phelps, thrashing machines in Shortsville, and for many years, nearly all of the grain drills used in the United States were made in Phelps, Shortsville, Macedon, and East Rochester. Early pioneers had depended on superstition and old sayings in their attempt to get better crop yields. The Old Farmer's Almanac was their main textbook. The phases of the moon guided planting and harvesting. Many believed the way to protect fruit trees from insects or disease was to pour whiskey into a hole bored in a tree's root. Having a woman drag her clothing around a field by moonlight was thought to do the same for crops. Just as the growth of commercial farming resulted in new inventions, it also brought new methods. Farmers experimented to improve crop varieties and livestock breeds. This was the beginning of scientific agriculture. County fairs, besides providing recreation and entertainment, were a means of comparing crop varieties and livestock bloodlines. What did the villages look like? Streets were dirt, often graveled to keep down the dust. The main streets, cobblestoned in the larger communities. Sidewalks, if any, would be made of wooden planks or, in later years, of brick or slate. The town pump offered a cool drink to passers-by. Next to it, a trough furnished water to horses and dogs. Every village had a school, a church, one or more general stores, and shops of some of the craftsmen and professional persons. As the villages grew, the business districts became more compact. Stores and other businesses now were in adjoining buildings instead of each being surrounded by a yard. The inns or hotels, however, still needed space for parking coaches, carriages, and wagons. Taverns and hotels were not only a place to obtain food, drink, and a night's lodging, but also a community center. The inn may have been the site of the post office, although in some villages the post office was in the general store. By 1860, most of the 49 communities in Ontario County had its own post office building. Ontario County has always been noted for its emphasis on education. From the early one-room structures to the larger schools of the later period, from the elementary level to colleges. On January 28, 1791, just 2 years after the county was formed, an endowment was established to create Canandaigua Academy. In 1860, there were over 200 schoolhouses in the county. One example is the Ansley School on Preemption Road. Private seminaries and academies also flourished. The Canandaigua Academy for boys, the Bloomfield Seminary, and female seminaries in Geneva and Canandaigua. Hobart, the third college in upstate New York, was established in Geneva in 1822. Geneva Medical College, the first medical school west of Utica, became a department of Hobart years later. It is noted for graduating in 1849 the very first woman doctor, Elizabeth Blackwell. The church was of great importance to village life, both for religious services and for social contact. Like the school, it was one of the first structures built in a new settlement. Recreation took many forms. Sometimes it was associated with work, such as a corn husking party or a quilting bee. Dancing was a favorite amusement, whether an informal affair in a neighbor's barn or a more elegant party at the village inn. 19th century children played games and engaged in vigorous fun, rolling hoops, walking on stilts, and racing with their friends were favorite outdoor pastimes. Toys and games were usually homemade. In the summer, families enjoyed picnics, attended religious camp meetings, eagerly looked forward to the annual county fair, and if near enough to Canandaigua or Seneca Lake, could take a trip on an excursion boat. In winter, there was coasting for the children, ice skating for all ages, and most fun of all, a sleigh ride behind a pair of lively horses. In 1806, Jesse Hawley was in default on a mortgage, in debt and being sued by his creditors. Although he initially fled to avoid prosecution, he returned to Ontario County in August 1807, turning himself into Sheriff Elijah Tillotson. Here on the corner of Coach Street and Main Street in Canandaigua stood Tillotson's Inn, which also served as the county jail. Jesse Hawley served a 20-month sentence in that jail.
During his imprisonment, Pauli wrote 14 articles about a project which had interested him for a number of years. Construction of a canal from Buffalo to Albany. Newspapers throughout the United States reprinted the articles which came to DeWitt Clinton's attention. The Erie Canal, as it came to be called, became Clinton's personal and political goal. The plaque of the Waylock Building in Syracuse contains a brief history of the Erie Canal.
Construction of the Erie Canal was hailed as the greatest engineering accomplishment to that time. Under the leadership of Governor DeWitt Clinton, construction began July 4, 1817. With little technical knowledge, thousands of workers surveyed, blasted, and dug a 363-mile canal across the state. They erected aqueducts to carry the canal over rivers and valleys. They built 83 locks to take the canal over changes in ground levels. When completed in October 1825, the Erie connected Albany and Buffalo and became the main route between the Atlantic Ocean and the Great Lakes. A ceremony marking completion of the Erie Canal was held in Buffalo on October 26, 1825. Jesse Hawley, in the presence of Governor Clinton and other dignitaries, spoke from the canal boat, Seneca Chief.
This epic will be recorded in the tablets of history as among the greatest events of our nation for having in 8 years, with $8 million, made the longest canal, in the least time, with the least experience, for the least money, and of the greatest public utility of any other in the world.
At the conclusion of the speeches, the signal was given and a cannon from Oliver Perry's War of 1812 fleet was fired in salute. Other cannon from the fleet, placed within hearing of each other, relayed the message from Buffalo to New York Harbor. The Grand Canal is completed. The greatest celebration New York City had ever seen took place at the Wedding of the Waters in New York Harbor. Immediately upon the canal's completion, the rates for shipping dropped from $100 a ton to $10 a ton. As slow as it was still faster than other means of transportation. In the mid-1800s, improvements in the canal system were begun. The unimagined success of the Erie Canal created lateral or feeder canals. The Seneca-Cayuga Canal served Ontario County at Geneva, running from Montezuma into Cayuga Lake through Seneca Falls to Seneca Lake. It still operates today. Canandaigua proposed and passed a local resolution to form a canal between the Erie Canal here at Port Gibson, Ontario County, and Canandaigua Lake. Local citizens pledged money, but it was never done. Why? No one seems to know. One of the greatest single public engineering works of the 19th and 20th centuries, the Erie Canal revolutionized the economy of Ontario County, New York State, and the nation. Along with the flood of manufactured products brought by the Erie Canal, came people with different ideas and different customs. They affected politics, religion, and culture, both locally and nationally. An incident occurred in Canandaigua a year after the opening of the canal that contributed in part to the development of modern political parties. The Ontario County Jail has been on this site on Ontario Street in Canandaigua since 1813. Here on September the 12th, 1826, began a series of events which would have widespread political effects. But much of the story remains a mystery to this day. William Morgan had, in 1826, published a book revealing the secrets of masonry. Jailed here for an unrelated minor offense, he was kidnapped by unknown men, taken to Fort Niagara, and imprisoned for several days in an unused powder magazine. He was never seen again. Public reaction to Morgan's abduction and presumed murder soon turned into an anti-Mason movement, which spread across the nation. Although it was very influential for a few years, the anti-Masonic party faded from the political scene after 1832. In its brief tenure, it had three firsts. It was the first party to have a platform, the first third party, and the first party to have a nominating convention, which was held in Baltimore in 1831. Out of the anti-Masonic movement, the welter of parties, and the coming of the Civil War, the Republican Party was born. The Erie Canal affected more than fraternal and political organizations. From 1800 to 1830, an intense religious movement called Revivalism swept over this area. Some people, desiring a better and more meaningful life, thought it could be found in a return to some of the old ways. One religious group was called the Shakers, named for a combination of the words shaking Quakers. The Shakers attempted to create Christian communities based on a commitment to work, very simple living, and abstinence from pleasure. They founded settlements on Sotus Bay in 1823 and at Sunye on the Genesee River in 1836. Important new religions were also born in Western New York out of this emotional revivalism. This is the home of Joseph Smith, Jr., located just outside of Palmyra, New York. Here in the early 1820s, he lived with his family. Like many other 14-year-old boys in Ontario County, Joseph Smith found farm life in the 1800s to be hard work, clearing the land, plowing, planting, and other chores that filled nearly every waking hour. Religious faith was a great concern to him. He attended religious revivals, but he found it impossible to decide which church to join. Finally, he turned to the Bible. A verse therein inspired him to ask God through prayer. Here in this grove of trees near the family farm, according to Joseph Smith's account, he received his answer. Here he claimed he had a vision which he believed to be God, the Father, and his Son, Jesus Christ. The figures told him to join none of the churches, for later he would play an important role in the restoration of church. Later, according to Joseph Smith, he had another vision which revealed the location on Hill Cumorah of an ancient book of scripture written on metal plates. This became known as the Book of Mormon. Several months later, Joseph Smith, then aged 25, in this cabin in Fayette, New York, formally founded the Church of Jesus Christ of the Latter-day Saints, nicknamed the Mormons. Since that time, the church has spread around the world. Still other religious denominations arose. William Miller believed that the end of the world was coming soon. He claimed to know exactly when it would occur. Miller founded a religious group known as the Adventists. Today, they are still active in American religious life. The mainline church members who became caught up in the spirit of revivalism were known as evangelicals. They were behind the three most important movements for social reform in 19th century America: temperance, abolitionism, and women's rights. By 1832, the Ontario County chapter of the New York State Temperance Society claimed nearly 5,000 members. Myron Clark, a native of Naples and a resident of Canandaigua, ran for governor in 1859. Temperance beliefs were part of his platform. He was elected governor of New York in 1859, Ontario County's only governor. Like temperance, the abolitionist movement found strong support in the evangelical Protestant churches during the 1830s.
By the 1850s, Ontario County supported national anti-slavery and abolition movements. One of the abolitionist leaders in Western New York and the nation was Frederick Douglass. He was a slave who had fled to the North. He settled in Rochester and published a newspaper called the North Star, promoting the abolition of slavery. Douglass visited Ontario County many times during the 1840s and 50s. A widower, Douglass married Helen Pitts, who was born in Honeyoy, a descendant of Honeyoy's first white family. After the United States government enacted the Fugitive Slave Law in 1852, the anti-slavery movement gathered momentum. The law required local officials in free states, like New York, to help capture and return slaves to the South, where slavery was still legal. In response, some anti-slavery Northerners developed a network of hiding places called the Underground Railroad. Auburn's Harriet Tubman, herself a runaway slave, was called the Moses of her people. She led hundreds to freedom at great personal risk. Her grave is in Auburn. Although many worked to free the slaves, few did anything to better their condition. They suffered severe discrimination as part of their daily lives. The women's rights movement also had its beginnings in revivalism. American women in the 1800s did not hold the same rights as men. They could not vote in elections and often had no control of property they owned or even of their own wages. With few exceptions, they were excluded from business, commerce, and the professions. In 1848, in Seneca Falls, New York, over 300 delegates attended the first Women's Rights Convention, led by reformers Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Lucretia Mott. They recruited Susan B. Anthony to assist them. In their Declaration of Sentiments, signed at the Seneca Falls Presbyterian Church, they declared that all men and women are created equal. The convention called for women to receive the full rights and protection of American citizenship. Carolyn Richards wrote in her diary,
December 20th, 1855. Susan B. Anthony is in town and spoke in Bemis Hall this afternoon. She said the world would never go right until the women had just as much right to vote and rule as men. I could not make grandmother agree with her at all, and she said we might better all of us stay at home.
None of these issues, temperance, abolition, or women's rights, was to be quickly or easily resolved, but the tradition of many working together toward a common goal continues. Two groups from Ontario County were at the forefront of the westward movement. Both came out of revivalism. July 4, 1836, a train of covered wagons led by Dr. Marcus Whitman of Rushville and his wife, Narcissa Prentice Whitman of Prattsburg, broke through the South Pass of the Rocky Mountains. This established the Oregon Trail and eventually opened the far west to settlement from the east. It took great courage and know-how to organize and execute an expedition of this magnitude. They planned to cross 3,000 miles of virtually unknown wilderness with all of the barriers nature could provide. Slowly, Whitman's wagon train made its way westward. Theirs was the first covered wagon to complete the old Trapper Trail as far as Fort Boise on the Snake River. And Narcissa was the first white woman to cross the Great Divide of the Rocky Mountains. They were now beyond the boundaries of the United States in what was known as Oregon Country. At Wylett Pool, Wyoming, they founded their mission,
Although it grew rapidly, the settlement faced problems. Both England and the United States claimed the area. English trappers and traders harassed the mission, and uncertainty over which country had sovereignty complicated their dealings with the Native Americans. The Whitmans opened the way for the thousands of pioneers who would flood into the Oregon country. Occupancy by American pioneers effectively settled the ownership of the land and thereby the Canadian border, which was formally ratified later by treaty. With this tremendous migration of settlers into the Oregon country, the Indians felt threatened. In 1847, the Cayuse Indians, blaming the missionaries for a measles epidemic, attacked the mission. Marcus and Narcissa Whitman and 12 others were killed. Among the first organized community groups to move west on the Oregon Trail was the Mormons. Shortly after the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints was organized, local opposition developed. The new church, seeking a more hospitable location, moved to Ohio, on to Missouri, and later back to Illinois. There they built a new city named Nauvoo in a swampy bend in the Mississippi River. Soon, it rivaled Chicago in size. In 1844, in Nauvoo, Joseph Smith, aged 39, was assassinated by an angry mob. Once again, the Mormons put the few possessions they could carry into covered wagons and trekked westward. Under the leadership of Brigham Young, also from this area, they traversed the Oregon Trail. They passed through the South Pass, over the Wasatch Mountains, and along the red-walled cliffs of Echo Canyon. Where Emigration Canyon broadens, Brigham Young stopped, looked, and then said, "This is the place." Today, that place is Salt Lake City, capital of Utah, and world headquarters of the Church of Jesus Christ of the Latter-day Saints. This was the largest mass migration in United States history, the transplanting of an entire city. The westward expansion of America helped bring about the Mexican and the Indian Wars. It also rapidly brought new states into the Union. The North and South struggled to maintain the balance of power between slave and free states. The answer was not to be found in compromise, but in war. Even before the middle decades of the 19th century, dissolving the Union was being advocated by those who favored states' rights over a strong central government. The North and South quarreled over section differences on economic and political issues. But the poison that infected our land was slavery. Generally, the people of Ontario County, along with the rest of the North, strongly supported the national government. Many spoke out against slavery. Mainline churches, and especially the Society of Friends, the Quakers, took a strong stand against slavery. The Geneva Courier incorporated the Free Soil slogan into its banner. Besides the political and philosophical reasons for Ontario County residents to be interested in the growing conflict, there was also a local connection. Canandaigua Academy graduate Stephen Douglas believed in allowing residents of the Western Territories to decide the slave or free question upon attaining statehood. This was known as popular sovereignty. Douglas had lived near Clifton Springs and studied law in Canandaigua. History remembers him for the Lincoln-Douglas debates. These occurred during the 1858 campaign for senator from Illinois, which Douglas won. In 1860, he ran against Lincoln again, this time for the presidency. This time, Lincoln won. The new Republican Party had many followers in Ontario and nearby counties. One of its leaders, Auburn's William Seward, foresaw the Civil War, calling it the irreconcilable conflict. Seward became Lincoln's Secretary of State and was known for Seward's folly, the purchase of Alaska. On hearing of the attack on Fort Sumter from Charleston, South Carolina, local residents rallied to the Union cause. Noah T. Clark, principal of Canandaigua Academy, urged his students to enlist. 125 left their classrooms, almost closing the school. In Waterloo, Wyman Johnson hung his scythe in a tree. He told his parents he would return to get it. In 1864, he died of wounds received in battle. The scythe is still in the tree. Under local militia general John Granger, Canandaiguans raised over $7,000 in one evening. Local militia did not have long to wait to be called up. On April 15, 1861, President Lincoln asked the Union states to send 75,000 men to defend the nation. Before the war was over, nearly 5,000 men from Ontario County served in at least 29 regiments. One of the first to go was the 33rd New York Volunteers, known as the Ontario Regiment, although several companies came from Seneca County and elsewhere. It was commanded by Colonel Robert F. Taylor from Rochester. The Ontario Regiment fought gallantly in the defense of Washington, D.C., at Williamsburg, the Seven Days, and Malvern Hill during McClellan's Peninsula Campaign, and at South Mountain during Lee's push to Antietam, the bloodiest battle of the war. Just a month before its scheduled return to Canandaigua, the 33rd was part of the costly and ill-fated Union attack on Fredericksburg, Virginia. After the Emancipation Proclamation, the Civil War became a bloody crusade. Volunteers dwindled. A military draft began, and the payment of bounties for substitutes started, eventually ranging up to $1,000. In July 1862, New York's 126th, the best-known local regiment, left its training camp in Geneva and headed south. Led by Colonel Eliakim Sherrill, the 126th had men from every town in Ontario County. Captured at Harper's Ferry, the men of the 126th were freed and later served again. The bloodbath at Gettysburg claimed 28,000 dead, wounded, or missing Union soldiers, and 20,000 Confederate soldiers. Hundreds from Ontario County died. Carolyn Richards wrote,
July 4th, 1863. The terrible Battle of Gettysburg brings to Canandaigua sad news of our soldier boys of the 126th Regiment. Colonel Sherrill was instantly killed. Also Captains Wheeler and Herendeen, Henry Wilson and Henry P. Cook. Captain Richardson was wounded.
By 1864, the 126th was part of General Grant's push to the war's end. At Petersburg, Richmond, the Wilderness, and Cold Harbor, names all too familiar to families waiting at home. In the Battle of Cold Harbor, 7,000 Confederate and Union soldiers lost their lives in 20 minutes. The first major battle of the Civil War began on Wilmer McLean's farm,
To protect his family from danger, he moved to the village of Appomattox Courthouse. And there, 3.5 years later, on April 18, 1865, his home was the site of Lee's surrender to Grant. McLean commented,
"The war began in my front yard and ended in my parlor."
Observing the surrender was a top member of Grant's staff, Ely Parker, a Seneca Indian from Pen Yan. Across the North, communities celebrated.
April 10th, 1865. Lee has surrendered, and all the people seem crazy in consequence. The bells are ringing. Boys and girls, men and women are running through the streets, wild with excitement.
But just 5 days later,
Abraham Lincoln was assassinated yesterday. How soon has sorrow followed upon the heels of the joy of victory. The bells have been tolling. Oh, how horrible it is.
Six Ontario County soldiers received the nation's highest military decoration, the Medal of Honor. Nearly one-third of the local boys who marched away never returned. In North and South, graves of the blue and gray were decorated. Waterloo, New York, just east of Geneva, celebrated the first community-wide observance of Memorial Day on May 5, 1866. In later years, communities across the county and the country vowed never to forget all the brave young men who saved their Union. More than 620,000 Union soldiers were killed or wounded, approximately three times as many American casualties as in Vietnam. No records exist for the Confederates, but certainly the war claimed a comparable number. Before the Civil War, people would say, "The United States are." After the war, they said, "The United States is." We had become a nation indivisible.
67 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so conceived and so dedicated can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggled here, have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, and for the people, shall not perish from the earth.